Praise the Lord. Today we are going to see about the life of Jesus and overview. Before this message, let us also pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this wonderful day, my Jesus. Thank you for uniting us together through this Zoom meeting in such a way. Yes, my Lord, we learn more about God and learn more about you also, my Jesus, in such a way your life and ministry of is going to be our role model in our lives, my Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are the God who came in flesh and died on the cross for our sin, my Jesus. So today we are going to study about your life, my Lord. Thank you, Lord. Please open our internal eyes, spiritual eyes, in such a way they can understand more about you, my Jesus, and they reflect the character of you in their life, my Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for taking our sin on yourself and dying on the cross in such a way, my Jesus. Give us eternal life, my Jesus. As we are going to meditate about your life, my Jesus, let all our life is going to be reflect your life and character in our day-to-day life, my Jesus. I pray that each and every children has that mentality in their soul. They learn the life of Jesus, not just to learn and forget it, but to learn about the life of Jesus and reflect the life of Jesus in their life, my Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let them also accept the Jesus as a Savior, my Jesus. Fill them with the Holy Spirit, my Lord. Lead them in the correct path, my Jesus. Hallelujah. As you are came to this world, my Jesus, you are sinless, but you took our sin in order for you, my Jesus, as your sin and died on the cross, my Jesus. You take away the debts from us, my Lord. Yes, my Jesus, give us eternal life, my Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Not only that, my Lord, you have proclaimed the kingdom of God. Yes, my Jesus, we are in the kingdom of God. Yes, in your second coming, we are going to rule this world, my Jesus. We have that faith in you, my Lord. As we are living our life in this world, my Jesus, let us all see you are the way you lived in this world, and let us also reflect the way we have to live in our life, my Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I surrender myself and the kids in thy feet, my Jesus. Bring so many children, my Lord. Those children who don't know about the Jesus, don't know about the Bible. There are so many children in the whole world, my Jesus. This is a world connecting network. So let you all connect all the children who want to be, who want to know more about you, my Jesus, who want to read a Bible, who want to learn the Bible, who want to understand the Bible. There are so many people, so many children, so many teens in this world who are having this enthusiasm in their life, my Jesus. Please allow the path to know those children and make to join in this Zoom meeting, my Lord. I surrender myself in the study in thy feet, my Jesus. Whatever I study, whatever I teach, whatever I'm going to speak, my Lord, it is from you, my Jesus, not by me, my Lord. Only by your anointing of Holy Spirit, I'm going to teach the children, my Jesus. I surrender myself and children in thy feet, my Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. Today we are going to see about the life of Jesus and overview Jesus, his life. Okay. And this we are going to see, as you all know that in the Bible, previous class, I taught you about the overview of the Bible. Okay. In the Bible, the New Testament, there are four Gospels. Okay. So why we need four Gospels? Why are there four Gospels? That's what first I'm going to teach you. Because in the Gospel only, we are going to see the life, ministry, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ. There are four Gospels in the Bible, the New Testament. That's the we should know that why there are four Gospels, first of all. So first of all, there are four authors for the four Gospels. You all know that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew was a tax collector, but Mark was a companion of Peter. I know very well. You all know about Matthew. Matthew is a tax collector, which comes in Matthew chapter 9, when Jesus told the man who was a Levi, was also called Matthew, to come and follow him. He left everything and followed Jesus Christ. So he was a tax collector. You all know that. But about Mark, you don't know, actually. But I want to teach you about the Mark. Second gospel, that is a Mark gospel according to them. So who is this Mark? The Mark was a companion of Peter. So whatever he wrote is what Peter taught in his messages. So that's what Mark wrote. Mark was not a disciple of Jesus Christ. He was the only companion of Peter. Maybe he became Christian because of Peter's teaching and ministry. Okay, and then next was Luke. You all know that Luke was a physician. He was a companion of Paul. And John was a fisherman who was a disciple of Jesus Christ. Of all four authors who wrote the four Gospels, Matthew and John were disciples of Jesus. Mark and Luke, they were not the disciples of Jesus. Mark was the companion of Peter and Luke was the companion of Paul. Okay, Mark was the companion of Peter. His Gospel contains what he had heard from Peter. Luke was the companion of Paul. His Gospel contains what he had heard from Paul. Because in all, and from second and not in the first missionary journey, but in second and third missionary journey, Luke was traveling along with Paul. Luke was traveling along with Paul. Not only that, what happened when Paul was arrested in the Roman imprisonment, Luke was also there in the Rome, and then he started to verify about the life of Jesus Christ, what Paul taught, to all the people separate, like Mary. He went and interviewed Mary, he interviewed Elizabeth, all these people in person. Luke went and talked with them, he took an interview, and he took the information from them, and then he made him correct study, and then he wrote it chronologically, the life of Jesus Christ. That was Luke data. So this is, can you see the difference here? Now next is for audience. You all know that we are writing to somebody. We are, if a person is writing, he has to send it to somebody. For somebody only, he is writing. That we call it as the audience, isn't it? For example, I'm teaching for whom? I'm not teaching by myself, for not to the wall. I'm teaching to you, isn't it? The audience are there. The same way, the four Gospels are written to four different types of audience. So Matthew wrote for the church in Jerusalem, okay? So I'm teaching you all new things which you don't know at all. Understand? So be careful and try to remember it, okay? This and all, you should know it very well. Matthew wrote for what? Church in Jerusalem. But now it is compiled in the Bible. We are reading Matthew as a for the life ministry and the death of Jesus Christ. But actually it was written to whom? For the church in Jerusalem. Afterwards, they took the copies and sent it to the other churches. Then Mark wrote for the church in Rome. Okay, and Luke wrote for an individual named Theophilus, a believer of Greece. Only Luke was written for an individual man named Theophilus, and he was a believer of Greece. He belonged to Greece. He was a Greek, okay? And then this is about Luke. What about John? John wrote for the church in Ephesus. You know that John was the head of the churches in Ephesus. So he wrote the letter for the church in Ephesus, because there are so many apostasies were started to started to come in the church of Ephesus. So John wrote the gospel about the gospel of John to the church in Ephesus. So Matthew to the church in Jerusalem, Mark the church in Rome, Luke to the individual man named Theophilus, was a believer of Greece. John wrote for the church in Ephesus. Okay, so these are the four audience. Very good. What are the four perspectives? Each and every person, can you know that certain information are there in one gospel, certain information not there in other gospel, certain miracles are there in certain one gospel, other miracles, certain miracles are not there in the other gospel. It is so much of difference are there. A certain information incidents are given in one, that's not given other. Why like that? Why they deliberately removed it? Is there anything? What is wrong in it? Nothing is wrong in it, because the four authors are writing their four audience with the four perspectives. Okay, let us see what are the perspectives for each and every gospel. Matthew wrote for Jewish Christian, because you know, Matthew wrote the church of Jerusalem. In the church of Jerusalem, most of the members, most of the believers are Jewish people. So Matthew wrote for Jewish Christian. He present Jesus the Messiah who fulfilled the Old Testament prophecy. You all know that Jewish people as a Old Testament copy as a sacred, the scripture, holy scripture. So that we called as the Torah. So they were expecting a Messiah, and it was written in the Old Testament, so many prophecies about the life of Messiah, which is going to take place in future. Their main intention, they are waiting for the Messiah to come to the world. So Matthew wrote for Jewish Christians. That's why he presented Jesus the Messiah who fulfills the Old Testament prophecies. Understand? Now, what about Mark? Mark wrote for Romans. Romans don't know about Old Testament. Understand? The Romans here, they converted, they accepted Jesus as a Christ from that they belong to Rome. Okay. They were Romans. So the Romans always like to learn about
the action, the miracles, and all these things, the deeds. They're very active people. They want to know that. They don't want to hear lectures, teachings, messages. So, well, since Mark wrote to the Romans, he stresses Jesus' action rather than teaching. Why there is more action in Matthew? In Mark, because Mark wrote to the Romans. Romans want to hear more about the actions, the miracles, the signs. They don't want to learn about they don't want to hear the teachings and messages. So Mark was stressed Jesus' action rather than teaching. He presents Jesus the servant. Okay? Matthew presents Jesus the Messiah. Understand here, Jesus the servant whose rejection, suffering and death were an essential part of his mission. He came to serve the people. He did not come to get the service from the people. That's what Jesus told. Okay, so Mark, how Mark presents Jesus Christ as Jesus the servant. How Matthew presents Jesus Christ, Jesus the Messiah who fulfilled the Old Testament prophecies. How Luke wrote for an individual named Theophilus, a Christian layman of Greece. Possibly even a convert of Luke. He may be converted through the teaching and preaching of Luke. He presents Jesus how? The Son of Man. Why? What a Son of Man? Who brings salvation by identifying with the humanity. Man means what? Humanity. Son of Man. So, who brings salvation by identifying with humanity in all its weakness. Can you see there? Most of the things, the downtrodden people, the women, all those things are emphasized more in Luke. And he emphasized more about the sickness, healing of sickness, the weak people, the downtrodden people, the poor people, the layman, and these lepers. All these people are mentioned more in the Luke because Luke want to identify Jesus with humanity in all its weakness, because he want to present Jesus as a Son of Man. So try to understand, my children. Matthew present Jesus as Son of Messiah. Mark present Jesus as Jesus the servant. Luke present Jesus as Jesus the Son of Man. And then how John presented Jesus, John wrote for the Christian. So he have to write according to the perspective of Christians. Okay, he present Jesus as Son of God, focus on the unity between Jesus and God the Father. That you see, I am the Father are the same. I came to the world to do the will of the Father. Whatever I learned from the Father, I teach you. Whatever I saw Father doing, I'm doing here. All these things are written by John because he represents Jesus as Son of God, focuses on the unity between Jesus and God the Father. So can you see here? That's why we need, there are four Gospels in the Bible which gives about her life, the ministry, the death, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus Christ. Understand? So in the case of four Gospels, there are four authors, and there are four audience, and there are four perspectives. Then I go to the eighth period of Jesus. Now I'm going to teach about the Jesus life, because why I taught about the Gospel is I'm going to teach you about the Jesus life, which is given in the four Gospels. So always you have in the mind why we need four Gospels. It is easy if there is one Gospel. If it is easy to chronologically arrange all together as one Gospel, we should not do it, because it was written by different authors, written to the different audience with the different perspectives. So after that, I'm going to teach about the yearly periods of the eight periods of Jesus' life. I'm going to divide the life of Jesus Christ into eight periods. Okay, this today I try to finish at least two periods. In the coming class, I'll try to finish two things. So we need at least four classes to finish the life of Jesus Christ, overview of the life of Jesus Christ. So the Jesus Christ life is divided into eight periods. Can you see here? Please see this chart. Birth and youth, that is until 12 years old boy, birth and youth, that is approximately 30 years, okay? After the youth, 12 years, we don't know about anything about Jesus. Suddenly, after 30 years, by the age of 30, he was baptized by John the Baptist. He entered the ministry. So we called how many years? 30 years. Where it happened? Where it happened? In Bethlehem, where he Egypt, where he was taken, and he came back and stayed in Nazareth until he entered into ministry. Jesus was staying in Nazareth. So the location is three places for birth and youth. Then what about the preparation for ministry? For the preparation for ministry, immediately it happened, he went to Jordan River. There he was baptized by John the Baptist. After the baptism, he was taken by Holy Spirit to the wilderness. So that is about preparation. So after he overcame the Satan, he started to do ministry. Then third one is early ministry in Judea. There are four parts in Israel. We can divide the Israel into four parts. As I said, four different areas. We call it as a Judea, Samaria, Galilee, then we call Perea. I will show you the map, then you can understand. Okay, yearly ministry in Judea, how many years? Only 8 months. Where in Judea? Judea and Samaria. In two places, Jesus did ministry how many months? 8 months. That we call the early ministry in Judea. Then ministry in Galilee. Okay, how many years Jesus did ministry in Galilee? For 2 years, for solid 2 years, Jesus did ministry in Galilee. That is, in location is Galilee. Okay, then the later ministry, there are two times Jesus did ministry in Judea. First he started ministry in Judea, then he went to Galilee and stayed there for 2 years. Again from Galilee, he returned back to Judea. So we call it as a third, as a fifth one, as a later ministry in Judea. Early ministry in Judea is 8 months. Later ministry in Judea is only 1 month. There he went to Perea and Judea. There he did both Perea and Judea. So 1 month he stayed there and he did ministry in Judea. Then what? Ministry in Perea. Okay. In ministry in Perea, how many months? Only 4 months. There was ministry in Perea. So he went both Perea and stayed in Judea like this. He was going there and come there and here. He was doing ministry in Perea and Judea. So ministry in Perea, only 4 months. Then after finishing his ministry in Perea, he directly went to Jerusalem. That we call the last week in Jerusalem. Last, how many weeks? We have 7 days. Okay. So 7 days, duration is 7 days. Judea and Jerusalem. There what happened? Crucifixion and resurrection, 7 days. The appearance after the resurrection, how many days? 40 days. Where it happened? Jerusalem and Galilee. In Galilee also, Jesus was the resurrected Jesus. The disciples saw the resurrected Jesus came in Galilee, because Jesus told the disciples to come to Galilee and Jesus wanted to visit them in Galilee, because most of his time he did ministry in Galilee, and all the disciples, most of the disciples belong to the area called Galilee. So this is the way I divide the Jesus' life into 8 periods. Okay, even though there are 4 gospels, how I'm going to teach you is that I'm going to teach in such a way, birth and youth, preparation for ministry. Then I'm going to teach how I'm going to cover the life of Jesus Christ, is where he did ministry. The area wise, I'm going to divide it. And in that particular area, how he did the ministry, that also chronologically. So one after another, I'm going to teach you correctly. So when you add all these things, Jesus' ministry is now how many days? 3.5 years. Okay. So now 8 months, 2 years, 1 month, and 4 months. Okay. So all these things, if you calculate it, come like 3 to 3.5 years. So the yearly ministry in Judea, ministry in Galilee, later ministry in Judea, ministry in Perea. So it is very easy, my children. So only this 3, 4, 5, 6, in this group only, we are going to see more teachings of Jesus, more miracles of Jesus. Other thing, you know, birth and youth, you all know that. Preparation also, you know that. So today I'm going to finish only 2 periods, that is the birth and youth and preparation for ministry. Okay, now let us go to the ministry of Judea. I told you, no, there are 4 areas in, because we are dividing the Israel into 4 areas. It is called Judea. Can you see here? This is Judea. This is Judea. Down is Judea. It's in the north. Okay. In the east, we have Perea. Here in the west, we have Samaria. In the middle, we have the Samaria. That is nothing but Samaria. Then we have the Galilee. Okay. So how many things are there? How many areas are there here? Judea. Okay. Judea. Perea, Galilee. But there is also Samaria. No, most of the people don't want to enter Samaria and cross Samaria. So when they want to go from Judea to Galilee, they go all the way around, not they cross Samaria, because people of Samarians are not pure Jewish people. They mingle with other Gentiles, and they are following Moses, and they are worshipping in Gerizim. They are not coming for worship. That's why they just sent the people away from them, the Samaritan people. So we cannot see the more ministry of Jesus in Samaria. Only when he crossed through the Samaria, Jesus met a woman on the in the well, okay, near the well. That's only there in Samaria. Then in Samaria also, Jesus wanted to preach the gospel. The people didn't allow him. Then the Samaritan people also accept Jesus as Savior because of that lady who accepted Jesus as a Messiah. That's all we can see in the life of Messiah. But other areas where Jesus did ministry is mainly in Judea, Galilee, and Perea. So when to understand, my children, so these places, three places are very, very important. Try to understand. Can you see here? So Jesus completely covered the entire area of Israel. You can see here, there is a Dead Sea. There is a Jordan River. Okay. And this is the Sea of Galilee. Around the Sea of Galilee, Jesus did ministry how many years? 2 years. Here we call a Yarmouk River. So from here, we have got the Yarmouk River. And the Sea of Galilee is start from a Hermon Mountain. That Hermon Mountain is full of snow. The snow melt, and the Jordan River starts from there, and it end in Dead Sea. It starts from Mount Hermon and it ends in the Dead Sea. In the Dead Sea, you have only the salt and you cannot immerse. You started to float on the water, and there are no oxygen here, no living things are there because it is full of salt. Okay, that is called Dead Sea, but the river starts from Mount Hermon, and we call it as a Judea, Samaria, Perea, and Galilee. So you have to remember these places to understand about the life of Jesus Christ. So Jesus' ministry, first he started the ministry in Judea. From there, he went to Galilee. Again, from Galilee, he returned back to Judea. Then he went to Perea. From Perea, he entered Jerusalem for the last 7 days. In Jerusalem, he died, and he was seen as a resurrected man. After the resurrection, he was seen for 40 days, and from Jerusalem and the Olive Mount, he ascended to heaven. So this is about the map of Israel, okay? And here the Mediterranean Sea, and here the Sea of Galilee, here the Dead Sea, this is the Jordan River, okay? Can you understand, my children? Here's the Jabbok River, okay? Now we are going to see about the period one, Jesus' birth and youth, about 30 years. So in this case, what are the, you all know that there are four Gospels. All informations are not there in all Gospels. Certain information is there in one Gospel, and other Gospel that was not there, they have omitted it, because each and every Gospel has a different perspective, and they are given to different audience. So this birth and youth are mentioned in Matthew and Luke, not in Mark and John. So the first period, Jesus' birth and youth, is given by and given in the Bible portion, Matthew chapter 1 and 2, Luke chapter 1 and 2. Okay, try to understand Matthew chapter 1 and 2, Luke, and location, you all know that Bethlehem, Egypt, and Nazareth. Okay, Mark and John say nothing about the birth, childhood, and youth of Jesus. But Matthew and Luke record different incidents. They record all the incidents, one incident, one person, and other incident, other person, as mentioned. So this is what the difference. Mark and John never explained about the birth, childhood, and youth of Jesus. But moreover, Matthew and Luke also have different incidents. Okay, now I'm going to events of the first period. You all know that. I know, children, you all know all these events. Don't be afraid. You all know that. I'm just giving the overview of the life of Jesus Christ. You all know that first announcement was given to Zechariah. Okay, who was Zechariah? Zechariah was the father of John the Baptist. He was a priest, and he once got the permission through the Lord to enter the most high place. When he entered there, he was an old man. He had no children. Angel Gabriel went and met him in the most high place, inside the holy place, and gave the messages to Zechariah that John the Baptist was going to born. John was going to born to a boy was going to born, and he has to keep the name John. You all know that. So that is first. The New Testament starts with the announcement to Zechariah. Okay, announcement to Zechariah. Then what's the next announcement? Announcement to Mary. Announcement to Zechariah in Luke. Announcement to Mary in Luke, and Mary visits to Elizabeth. After Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit, he went and visited Elizabeth. Who is Elizabeth? Zechariah's wife. So John the Baptist's mother was Elizabeth. John the Baptist's father was Zachariah. That is also there in Luke chapter 1. Then Mary returned to Nazareth. Okay, because what was the native place was Mary Nazareth. Then announcement to Joseph, because Mary and Joseph were betrothed. Their engagement was over. Marriage was not over, but Mary was seemed to be pregnant. So by the Holy Spirit. So this information was announced to what? To Joseph, but that is not represented in Luke. That is given only in Matthew. Can you see here? So announcement to Joseph is given only in Matthew. Then the birth of John the Baptist is given only in the Luke, not in the Matthew. Okay, only in the Luke, not in the Matthew. Now I'm going to see about the birth of Jesus. This is about announcement. Then we come to birth of Jesus. Birth of Jesus is there both in Matthew 1:25, but in detail it is explained in Luke chapter 7. Then the announcement after the birth of Jesus, you all know this, it was the coming of Messiah to this world is announced to whom? First announcement to shepherds. That is given not in the Matthew, it is given only in the Luke. Then what happened after 8 days, Jesus was circumcised. That is given in Luke chapter 2. After the circumcision, after the Jesus' birth, after 40 days, Jesus was presented for rituals, for cleansing rituals. That is also given in Luke chapter 2. I'm going to teach you that in our coming thing. Then what happened after 1 year, the wise men came and visited the child Jesus. They were at the time, they were in Bethlehem. Okay, now this is in Matthew chapter 2, 1 to 12. That's not represented in Luke, understand? Then after that, they have to fly to Egypt. They ran to Egypt. Then that's in Matthew chapter 2. Then after 1 or 2 years, they stayed in Egypt for 1 or 2 years. When they stayed in Egypt, the king Herod killed the children of Bethlehem. That is also given in Matthew chapter 2, not Luke. Then after 1 or 2 years, Joseph, Mary and Jesus returned to Nazareth. That is given in Matthew chapter 2 and Luke chapter 2. So these are all the events of the first period. You should know this, my children, because as you are studying every day the Bible, if somebody asks you about the life of Jesus Christ, you have to tell it correctly and chronologically and one after another correctly. Understand? You have to take the correct Bible portion and explain them. By this age, you should know all these things, my children. That's why I want to give the overview of Jesus Christ, life of Jesus Christ, announcement to Zachariah. It was an ancient Near Eastern custom that a royal representative would be sent ahead to prepare the way for the visit of a king. For example, in the Near East, there was a king, for example. If the king want to visit a place or a city or a province, what the king do? No, he won't go immediately. First, he send his messengers to prepare a way for him. He prepare the, he make the way, road straight. He announced the people that the king is going to come, be ready to hear his message. And all these informations, the messenger go on tell first. Following the messenger only, the king come to that province or the place or the city. So this same way, this was did to Jesus Christ also, because Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's coming as the King of Jews. So a messenger was sent before the coming of Jesus Christ to the Jewish people. So that messenger was John the Baptist. Okay, that is what going to announce to Zechariah. The silence of 400 years from Malachi to Matthew was broken. How it was broken? Because until that 400 period, the last book in the Old Testament is Malachi, and the first book in the New Testament is Matthew. Between the Old and New Testament, how many years are there? 400 years. During the 400 years, there was no prophecy. We call it as a year of silence, the year of darkness. That year of darkness and the year of silence was broken by the message, announcement of message to Zechariah. Then the ministering priest Zechariah. What does Zechariah mean? Whom the Lord remembers, heard from God through an angel Gabriel. So when he was ministering in the temple inside the holy place, Gabriel came and visited Zechariah with a message from God. What is the message? John was to born of a barren couple and was to minister in the spirit and power of Elijah. That was a message, okay? The message was that the John was to born for a barren couple. Okay, John the Baptist was a prepare the people, bringing them to repentance before the Lord's coming. That was announced to whom? Zechariah. That we called as the announcement to Zechariah. So who was John the Baptist? John the Baptist was a messenger who would prepare the people. Why? Bringing them to repentance before the Lord's coming, which is Jesus Christ's first coming. So for this announcement to Zechariah. And the next one is for announcement to Mary. What happened then? Gabriel visited Mary at Nazareth and announced the most glorious event of human history. What was the announcement? The Holy Spirit will come on you and the power of Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. That is given in Luke chapter 1, 26-38. So what is this? What do you mean by that? I don't understand power of Most High. The Holy Spirit will come on you. The power of Most High overshadow. What does it actually mean? So the Holy Spirit comes upon you means the human nature of Christ. Try to understand, man. What do you mean by Holy Spirit come upon Mary? The Holy Spirit come upon Mary means the human nature of Christ was produced in the womb of a virgin Mary. Why? By the creative act of God, that is Spirit. By the creative act of Spirit, what is going to happen? The human nature of Christ was produced in the womb of a virgin. Who was the virgin here? The Mary. Okay, so that means the Holy Spirit come upon you. What do you mean by Holy Spirit come upon you? The human nature of Christ was produced in the womb. Okay, the power of the Most High will overshadow you means the eternal Son of God united himself with the miraculously generated human nature in the womb of the Virgin. So what was first created, produced in the womb of the Virgin? The human nature of Christ was produced. And the human nature of Christ, what is going to happen is that the eternal Son of God is going to unite with them the human nature of Christ, which was produced in the womb. That we called as the power of Most High will overshadow you. So what happened? The deity and the humanity were united. Well, the deity, what do you mean by deity? The divine nature of the God, humanity, the human nature of the God were united. For what? For the redemption of the fallen race. Because already we were the Adam and Eve were obeyed of Satan and they ate the fruit which God forbidden, and the whole human race was in the fallen state. So to redeem the fallen race, the divine nature and the humanity were united for the redemption of the fallen race. And therefore, his name was to be Jesus, which means the Savior. Understand what you mean by this? The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. This is very, very important. That was the announcement to Mary. Understand, my children? What is the power of Holy Spirit will show overshadow you? What do you mean by the Holy Spirit come upon you? So there was a unity, the divinity and the humanity. What is divinity? The divine nature of God and the humanity, the human nature of the mankind were united for the redemption of the fallen race. And hence, his name was to be called Jesus, which means the Savior. So this is about what announcement to Mary. What was the third one? The third incident is Mary's visit to Elizabeth, which is given in Luke only, not in Matthew. Mary and Elizabeth were relatives. Now Mary knew she was to become a mother. Who was to, because already Gabriel announced, told Mary also that your relative Elizabeth was conceived for 6 months. Who announced? Not Elizabeth. The Gabriel announced to Mary. So Mary knew she was to become, who was going to become mother, Elizabeth, and her relative Elizabeth would give birth in 3 months. In 3 months, she's going to give birth because already she was 6 months. So Mary wanted to see Elizabeth so they could rejoice together because Mary was now conceived with the Holy Spirit. Elizabeth even was also with the miraculously, she was also conceived. Only the Virgin Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit, but the old Elizabeth was conceived by her husband Zechariah. So now the Elizabeth was also pregnant and she's going to deliver within 3 months. Now so Mary wanted to see Elizabeth so they could rejoice together. As Mary entered the house of Elizabeth, Elizabeth was filled with the Spirit, not only Elizabeth, and the unborn baby John in her womb was also filled with the Spirit. Both are filled with the Spirit. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months until the time of John's birth. Then she returned to Nazareth. By the time, when the time Mary returned to Nazareth, she was 3 months old, pregnant. Okay, now what happened? Announcement to Joseph. Now Joseph came to know that Mary was pregnant. They were not husband and wife. They were only betrothal. They were engagement. Their engagement was only over. They are not living together. So Joseph was very upset with Mary. Now what happened? Joseph did not. That's why God announced to Joseph to accept Mary, because what was conceived by the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's what the information announcement given to Joseph. Joseph did not begot Jesus Christ. He was the husband of Mary, of Jesus, who is called Christ. Jesus was born of a earthly mother without the need of an earthly father. This is called the doctrine of the virgin birth. Angel Gabriel announced to Joseph that Mary's boy was called Jesus the Christ. Then Angel Gabriel announced, so Jesus, Savior is a human name. What is a Jesus? Jesus means Savior, is his human name. Christ, which means anointed, is his official title. We always say Jesus Christ. Jesus is his human name, and Christ means what? Anointed is his official title. What is? Because he's anointed. So with Jesus the anointed, Christ means anointed. So the Christ is his official title because he was anointed king. In Hebrew, anointed means Messiah. So he is Jesus the Messiah. Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the anointed. That is the meaning of it. Okay. Now next is birth of John the Baptist. Now what happened? Now what happened? Joseph accepted Mary as his wife. Then what happened? John was going to born, John the Baptist. God's blessing was resting abundantly on Zechariah and Elizabeth. God sent them a baby boy, just he has promised, and they named him John, just as God has instructed. Zechariah wrote his name John on the tablet because Zechariah became dumb. Become mute, he cannot talk because he didn't believe what Gabriel told, so God made him not to talk like that. His mouth was totally shut. When he writes his name is John on the tablet, Zechariah's mouth was opened and he sang a hymn that gives us four pictures of what the coming of Jesus Christ to earth really means. So he opened the mouth and he sang a hymn prophetically. When he sang the hymn, he gives the four picture about who Jesus Christ is. Okay, in this prophecy, in this hymn we call it as a Benedict. He told about the four pictures. He emphasized the coming of Jesus Christ, his earthly ministry, in the form of four pictures. He represented the ministry of Jesus Christ in the form of four pictures. What are the four pictures? The opening of a prison door. It's a picture. Who is going to open the prison door? Jesus Christ. That is his earthly ministry. The winning of a battle. Jesus is going to win the battle against Satan. And on the cross, he is going to crush the head of the Satan. So the winning of a battle. And the cancelling of the debt. Because we were under the Satan and we were a slave under the Satan and under the sin. So he want to redeem us. So for Jesus gave the debt to the his life as a debt, his blood as a debt to redeem us from the slave as a sin as a slave to the Satan in the form of sin. Okay, the dawning of a new day, because the old days are over and a new glorious, beautiful, blessed day was dawn, is going to come. So these are the four pictures about Jesus Christ earthly ministry. What was this? Was represented or sung as a hymn by Zechariah prophetically. So in the hymn of Zechariah, there are the four pictures of Jesus Christ, the four pictures of coming of Jesus Christ and his earthly ministry. The opening of prison door, coming of Jesus Christ. Winning of a battle is coming of Jesus Christ. Cancelling of the debt is the winning of coming of Jesus Christ. Dawning of a new day is the coming of Jesus Christ. Then the birth of Jesus, which is given in Matthew and Luke. God has promised the Savior would be a human, not an angel. Okay, Jesus Christ is a human, but not an angel. And a Jew, not a Gentile. He was a Jew and he from a tribe of Judah. Where and all God promised this? All these promises are already given in Old Testament. Okay, a Jew, not a Gentile. He's from a tribe of Judah and from a family of David, and born of a virgin, born in Bethlehem. All these are already given in Old Testament, already promised in Old Testament about Savior. All these things are fulfilled in New Testament. Okay, during the birth of Jesus, Jewish people were under the Roman Empire and were ruled by Augustus Caesar. Who was ruling them? The Roman Empire is ruled by Augustus Caesar. Rome took a census every 14 years. For how many years? For every how many years? 14 years once, Rome took a census. Why? For both the military and tax purposes. They want to take tax from the people, and from the tax, they want to enrich the military. Every 14 years, the Romans took the census. Because the Jewish people were ruled by whom? The Roman Empire. So the Jewish people also are taken the census. Okay. For each Jewish male had to return to the city of his father. there is a Jewish male. They were all over the Israel. But what happened? Each and every Jewish man had to return to the city of his father to record his name. You cannot record in place where you are staying, where you were born. That place you have to go. The Jewish male has to go to record his name, his occupation, his property, and family. According to that, he has to pay tax. Everything he has to record in the place where the Jewish man was born. Understand that he has to do all of these occasions. So who went there? Joseph went along with Mary to Bethlehem because Joseph born and they only at the Bethlehem. At the Bethlehem, all of this occurred just as the scripture said. And Caesar unknowingly played an important role because what was prophesied, the Messiah is going to born in Bethlehem. But where the Mary and Joseph are staying, they were staying in Nazareth. From Nazareth to Bethlehem was 80 miles. They have to travel 80 miles and reach the Bethlehem to register his name, occupation, and property and family. So they traveled to Bethlehem. So God used Caesar's edict to move Mary and Joseph 80 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem to fulfill his word. What was the word? He was Messiah is going to born in Bethlehem, the city of David. It is written in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. That is actually fulfilled. Okay. Now, Jesus' birth and early childhood. Can you see here? Jesus, they were in Nazareth. Okay. Gabriel announces to Mary that she will bear a son. Where in Nazareth? Okay. From Nazareth, what happened? They went to Bethlehem. Okay, they went to Bethlehem. See here, they can you see here? Mary and Joseph journey is in red color. Is a Mary and Joseph, Joseph and Mary to Bethlehem, to Jerusalem. Okay, from Jerusalem they went to Bethlehem. Okay, they stayed in Bethlehem, the birth of Jesus. Okay, then Jesus is brought to the Jerusalem for sacrificial ceremony. Okay, all these things I'm going to teach you in coming slide. Okay, and only remember this: from Nazareth they went to Bethlehem. Can you see here? From Nazareth, from Bethlehem, how many miles? 80 miles. Okay, you have to travel. Okay, now I'll teach you other things when the information comes. Announcement to shepherds. Okay, the first announcement was Messiah's birth was given by an angel to shepherds. Why shepherds? Why not to priests or scribes? By visiting the shepherds, the angel revealed the grace of God towards mankind. Because shepherds were really outcast in Israel. They were really outcast. Their work made them ceremonially unclean because they're going to all places. They're not there. So they were called as ceremonially unclean. They kept them away from the temple for many weeks. They can't enter the temple immediately. They have to cleanse. They are ritually. They have to clean themselves. They make them wholly clean. And then only they can enter. They were outcast. That's why God's announcement, the Messiah's coming to the world announcement was given only to the shepherds. First, one angel appeared and gave the glad announcement that the Messiah was born in the city of David. That was announcement, glad announcement. And then a chorus of angels joined him and gave an anthem of praise. So first was announced by one angel. Then the chorus of angels joined him and gave him the anthem of price. This is what the announcement to shepherds. Now the shepherds knew what to look for. They were look for what? A newborn baby wrapped in a swaddling cloth and lying in a manger. Swaddling cloth is a long, big, lengthy cloth where a newborn baby was wrapped to make his foot and hand strength. So they wrapped the baby. So they wrapped in a swaddling cloth. We call it a swaddling cloth and laying on a manger. What is a manger? A feeding trough for the animals. After finding the baby, they reported the good news to others. God used some humble shepherds to be the first human witnesses that prophecy had been fulfilled and the Messiah had been born. That prophecy, fulfilled prophecy, was announced only to the first, to the humble shepherds, to be the first human witnesses. This is about the announcement to whom? Shepherds. Now, next is what? Jesus' circumcision on eighth day. After on the eighth day, each and every male Jewish child has to be circumcised. When Jesus was 8 days old, Jesus' parents circumcised him. Circumcision was a sign and seal of a covenant that God made with Abraham. When you see the Abraham, when God made a covenant with Abraham, each and every male child has to be circumcised, and this is a covenant which has to be in your flesh. You have to remember this always as a sign. I made a covenant. This will bring the future blessing to you. So every Jewish man, it was required for every Jewish male who wanted the practice of the Jewish faith. If a Jewish male want to practice the Jewish faith, he has to do the circumcision. In obedience to the Lord, Mary and Joseph gave him the name Jesus. After circumcision on eighth day, they named him Jesus, because that's what the name told by for that child to Mary. Understand? So they gave the name Jesus Christ. On the eighth day, the child Jesus was circumcised. That was a sign and seal of the covenant. Then Jesus' presentation on 40th day. Then what happened? 40th day, they have to present. What is called presentation? When the child was 40 days old, Mary and Joseph had to come to the temple for the purification rituals, because in Moses' law, after the child birth, the child has to be, the mother has to be purified. Okay, purification rituals are there. So they have to come to the temple for purification rituals described in Leviticus chapter 12. Understand? So they came for the presentation. What is the presentation? To do the purification rituals, they have to do the in temple in Jerusalem. So they went where now? To Jerusalem. They also had to redeem the boy, since Jesus was the Mary's firstborn. So after the exodus after the firstborn children of all the Egyptian were killed, God told the Jewish the people of Israel to redeem their firstborn boy baby. Okay, so because they have to redeem it and give it to God. Understand that we call it as a redemption. So they have to redeem the boy, first boy, since Jesus was the Mary's firstborn. They had to pay a 5 shekel to redeem the redeemer, who would one day redeem us with his precious blood. The father and mother gave 5 shekel to the temple to redeem the firstborn baby, because one day that baby is going to be the great redeemer, and he's going to redeem us with his precious blood. They were very poor to offer a lamb, so they offered a pair of dove. So in the case of presentation or the purification ritual, they have to pay, the parent has to pay 5 shekel, and they have to offer a lamb or a pair of dove. If they are rich, they can offer a lamb. If they are poor, they can offer a pair of dove. But in the case of Mary and Joseph, they were very poor. They are very poor to offer a lamb. So they offered a pair of dove, and they gave 5 shekel to redeem Jesus, because Jesus was the Mary's firstborn. Because the first, each and every firstborn has to be redeemed, because all the firstborn child of the Egyptians were died on the 10th plague when they came out of Egypt, when they were under slavery in Egypt. That's why they have to redeem the firstborn baby. Since Jesus was the Mary's firstborn, they have to redeem the baby with 5 shekel, and they have to sacrifice a lamb or a pair of dove. Since they were poor, they cannot offer a lamb, so they offer a pair of dove. So Jesus birthed an early childhood. Now, what happened? From Nazareth, they went long, 80 kilometers to Bethlehem, and after 8th day, there he was circumcised, and they named him Jesus, and they went to Jerusalem. Why? For presentation, for purification rituals. Then they came and stayed in Bethlehem. Okay. Then what happened? We'll see that Jesus' birth and early childhood. Can you see here? From Nazareth, they went to Bethlehem. From Bethlehem, they after the childbirth, on the 40th day, they went to Jerusalem. Okay. Then what's going to happen? We'll see that. Okay. We'll see that now. What is going to happen? Visit of wise men. After one year, where they are staying, they didn't go to Nazareth. Some theologians are telling they went to Nazareth, then again they came back and stayed in Bethlehem. That's what they are telling. Okay, after all these 40 days are over, they went to Nazareth, and after they stayed in Nazareth for some time, they immediately changed the place to Bethlehem. We don't know why. Joseph and Mary again came and stayed in Bethlehem. Okay, so they were staying in the Bethlehem. After 1 year, what happened? After 1 year, the wise men visited Jesus. After 1 year, not immediately. These wise men belong to the learned class, those who were the advisors of the kings. They were the advisors of the kings. Okay, they were great learned men. They are wise people. They came from Babylon, the land of Abraham. They were familiar with the Jewish scripture and knew of the expectation of the coming messianic king. They knew about, they maybe knew about the Jewish scripture, because in the land of Bethlehem, Babylon, the Jewish people were captive for 70 years. It's also about there. And so they, wise people may know the Jewish scripture and the prophecy about the expectation of coming messianic king. Supernaturally, the star guided the wise man to Bethlehem. The wise man represents Gentiles who one day worship the king of the Jews, Jesus Christ. Now the Gentiles are not worshiping. These are not Jewish people. They were Gentiles. And they represent the Gentiles who one day worship the king of Jews, Jesus Christ. Not now. In one day, the Gentiles are also going to worship. That only these wise men were represented. The gift Magi was also interpreted as a foreshadowing of, foreshadowing of the Jesus life. The wise man brought the gifts. Those gifts also foreshadowing the Jesus life. What are the gifts the wise men brought? They bought gold, incense, and myrrh. The gold represents the royalty, foretells Jesus as a king. Why they bring this gold? Because Jesus was a king. And they bring incense, symbolizes of the prayer of the high priest rising to heaven. So incense means what? They put it on the coal or a hot coal, and the incense will come and go up in the air. So they be called as a prayer of the priest. So this incense foretells Jesus as a high priest. Okay. So what is the incense? The incense is symbolized as a prayer of the high priest rising to the heaven, foretells Jesus as high priest. So incense means foretell Jesus as high priest. Gold foretells Jesus as king. Myrrh, often used as a burial oil. Myrrh for what? Burial oil foretells Jesus' death. So gold foretells Jesus as king. Incense foretells Jesus as high priest. Myrrh foretells Jesus' death. One of the objects of their visit, which they themselves did not know, was to supply money for the child's flight to Egypt. Since they gave the gold, they were very poor. Now after this, they have to go back. They have to go to Egypt. For that, they need money. So unknowingly, they paid all these things because for the supply of money for the child flight to Egypt. The return of the wise men to their home countries may lead for the later preaching of the gospel. After that, they return to their home country and they may have preached the gospel. They may have told about the coming of Messiah to the Jewish people. Okay. So now this is what they gave: gold, incense, and myrrh. And then what happened? Flight to Egypt, because Herod presented that he wanted to worship a newborn king when he wanted to destroy him. Because how the Herod pretended to the wise men that he wanted to worship newborn king, but he really wanted to destroy him. So God wanted Joseph to take the child and Mary to flee to. God told warned Joseph to take the child and Mary to flee to Egypt. They stay in Egypt. The stay in Egypt was very short, probably a year or two, for Herod soon died. And it was safe to, when after the Herod died, that is, they again returned back to own country. So they stayed in Egypt a year or two. Then this is flight to Egypt. The children of Bethlehem were killed. After they went to Egypt, the Magi were seeking the king, but Herod was afraid of king and wanted to destroy him. Herod tried to kill Jesus, for he alone wanted to bear the title King of Jews, because the Magi came and asked Herod, where was the King of Jews born? We saw the star in the sky, which represents the birth of the Messiah, which is nothing but the King of Jews. So on hearing this, Herod wanted to try to kill the Jesus because he wanted to take the title of King of Jews. So Herod killed the baby boys, 2 years of age and under, who's still in Bethlehem, but Jesus was taken to Egypt before that. So Herod killed whom? The baby, boy babies, 2 years of age and under, who's still in Bethlehem. Then what happened? Returned to Nazareth after Herod died in 4 BC. When the Herod died? 4 BC. Then when Jesus was born? Jesus was born by 5 or 6 BC. Jesus was not born in 1 AD. Jesus was born at 5 or 6 BC because Herod died in 4 BC. An angel directed Joseph to take the child and Mary and return to Israel. Okay. Archelaus, now Herod was dead, but his son Archelaus was now ruling the Judea. But Archelaus was a very cruel man than the King Herod. So Joseph knew it was not safe for his family to stay in Judea. God spoke to Joseph in Mary, and he took his wife and son to Nazareth, which is in Galilee. So they want to stay in Judea, that is in Bethlehem. But the Judea was ruled by whom? Archelaus was very cruel man than his father Herod the Great. So what happened? they don't want to stay in Judea, but God spoke to Joseph and Mary and took his wife and son to Nazareth, which is in Galilee. So when Jesus was, Mary went to Jerusalem along with Jesus to observe what? So each and every year they go to Jerusalem to observe Passover feast. When Jesus was 12 years old, they took Jesus also to observe Jerusalem to observe the Passover feast. During the return journey, Jesus was missing. After 3 days, they found him in the midst of the teachers in Jerusalem, asking them questions and listening to their answers. After 3 days, this happened. Then after that, Jesus came and stayed with him, his parents. Okay, understand now? Now here, what we see here, Gabriel announced to Mary that she was born a bear a son in Nazareth. After that, they traveled to Bethlehem to give birth. From Bethlehem, they went to Jerusalem for purification. From they stayed in Bethlehem. From there, what happened? Jesus is brought to Jerusalem for a sacrificial ceremony. Then from there, they went to Mary and Joseph went to Egypt. So Joseph and family flee to Egypt because an angel forewarned them of Herod's intent to murder Jesus. From Bethlehem, they went to Egypt. And after 1 or 2 years, they returned back to Gaza, to first to Bethlehem. Then they went where? Directly to Nazareth and stayed there. Okay, they went there to Nazareth and stayed there. They don't want to stay in Judea because Judea was ruled by Archelaus, who was a very cruel person. So they went and stayed in Nazareth. This was the root of the early birth and childhood of Jesus Christ. Now, period two. Okay, so if possible, period two also I teach you in the next class because it is too much for you now. So the next class, I'll teach you about the preparation for ministry. And the third one is ministry in the early ministry in Judea. Okay, in the next class, I'll teach you all these things. So today we learned, what all things today we learned? We learn about first only one period of Jesus Christ. What is that period? That period is nothing but Jesus' birth and early childhood. Okay, and early childhood, that entirely it is represented in this chart, in the flow chart, in this map. In this map, can you see here? Gabriel announced to Mary that she was bear a son, okay, in Nazareth. From Nazareth, where they went, Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem. And there, the birth of Jesus by 4 or 6 BC. Jesus was not born on 1st AD. It was a wrong calculation. It was a wrong calculation. And Jesus was born on 4, 7 or 6 BC only, okay? That was a wrong calculation. They told them before Christ, after Christ, all these things was calculated. After the Roman Empire was dissolved, they calculate, they want to form a calendar, not a Roman calendar. And while they're calculating it, they made a mistake. That mistake made them to keep the birth of Jesus on 1 AD. But actually, Jesus was born on 4, 7 or 6 BC. The birth of Jesus, after the birth of Jesus, after the 40 days, Jesus is brought to Jerusalem for sacrificial ceremony. From that, they stayed in Bethlehem. Then who came and visited them? A group of Magi, that's also wrong. Every time we are telling that, like, a group of Magi came and visited Jesus. And Joseph was warned in the dream that Herod want to murder Jesus. So Joseph took the child and the Mary and went to Egypt. He stayed in the Egypt for 1 or 2 years. And after the Herod was dead, he returned back to Judea. Along the Judea, he was traveling, but Judea was ruled by Archelaus, and he warned in the dream, and they went and stayed in Nazareth. This is what has happened in his childhood, period one of Jesus Christ. Okay, with this, I'm going to finish it, and let us give you the application part. What is the application part? The application part is, what is the mission of Christ? What is the mission of Christ? So today we learned about only one period. What is the period? The birth and the youth of Jesus Christ. 30 years of Jesus Christ. Okay, how many years? 30 years of Jesus Christ. Okay, what is the mission of Christ? Mission of Christ is, there are 7 missions of Christ. Application part is 7 missions of Christ. Do God's will. What is the mission of Christ? The first mission of Christ is to do the God's will. What's the second mission of Christ? Save the sinners. Third mission of Christ, bring in everlasting righteousness. That is the righteousness of Messiah and the people. Everlasting righteousness. Third mission. fourth mission, destroy Satan's work in the world. Destroy Satan's work. And then fifth one is fulfill the all Old Testament prophecies about concerning himself. Fulfill the Old Testament prophecies. Sixth one, give his life as a ransom for us. And last one, complete the revelation. Entire Jesus want to complete. Everything was did in the mission of Christ. What are seven missions of Christ? Do God, save sinners, bring in everlasting righteousness, destroy Satan's work, fulfill the Old Testament prophecies, life, and complete the revelation. Now the memory verse, John 8:38. For I have come down from the heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. John 8:38, which is the to do God's will, is a mission of Christ. Praise the Lord, and uncle will come and do the questionnaire.